becomes thin and weak, it becomes like the branch of an old branch of a date palm. Allah uses that phrase. When Allah told the Sahaba, reflect on the greatness of Allah in His creation, Allah said, أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبْنِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ. Look at the camel. Whereas every animal gives the greatness of Allah, but the camel was that animal that was in front of every Arab. So wherever the Quran cites example, so it becomes easy for the audience to relate to. So the Prophet ﷺ said, which is that tree that is similar to the human? They said, no, we don't know. Then he said, it's your date palm. And then he explained the similarity. You know, it bears fruit all the time. A believer gives of good all the time. Even its waste matter is used in good things. Everything of a believer is generated into good. And the scholars have greatly created the tie and the link and the equation. Story over, gathering dispersed, everybody goes home. Part of the dinner table, Abdullah ibn Umar and Umar radiallahu anhumah get chatting. So the son tells the father, Umar, Dad, when Nabi Sassim asked the question, for your information, I knew the answer. So Umar said, my son, but this is not the time to tell me. You know, if you had to answer in front of Abu Bakr, the pride and the honor of your dad would have known no bounds. That my boy. And from this we learn that the pride of your child, even Sahaba, are not exempted from it. My mom always says, and may Allah preserve her and reward her, there is no joy like the joy of a child, and there is no pain like the pain of a child. When it hits the pain, it's the highest pain. One day I was carrying my sons, one on the back, one on the right and the left, and I'm walking and my hands were aching. And I remember the scholar, he said to me, Sheikh, your hands are paining. I said, well, you can see for yourself. He said, better your hands ache than your heart aches. Better your hands ache as years move on, they stab in the hearts of parents today. We know it has brought gloom and doom to the world. The very sweet child grows up to become a monster and you wonder when did this happen. So what did Abdullah ibn Umar say? Umar said, why didn't you answer in front of everyone? He said, Dad, respect compelled me to be silent in a gathering when Abu Bakr was present, radiallahu anhu. As much as I knew the answer, I couldn't muster the courage to open my lips, or lift my gaze, or dare articulate, or dare suggest or hint or insinuate. When I looked and I seen Abu Bakr, respect governed me, controlled me, kept me down. Umar was silent and he accepted that verdict. That was it, respect. So anyway, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, boy, أَتَأْذَنْ لِي. What was his character? He didn't minus that boy. He never ever, in his entire life, demoralized one human being or one creature. You and I can demoralize anyone and everyone. And remember, psychologically, when you demoralize a person, you create negativity in his heart and his mind. You create a negative wiring in his body. And he becomes a victim to that repeated negativity that you hurl towards him. The boy refuses, Nabi Sassim is fine. فَتَلَّهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ سَاسِمْ فِي يَدِهِ. Nabi Sassim takes the vessel, he honors the boy, respects the sentiments, gives it to him in his hand with a smile. Not snobbish, not harsh, not abrupt, not manners. What's your father's name? Gives it to him. That is the teachings and the beauty of Islam. Today, unfortunately, sometimes when the children make a noise in the masjid, then we say, If adults make a noise or adults are chatting and they're gossiping, then we say, we can't understand these adults. If it was children, we can still understand. But when it's children, we don't understand. When adults do things like children, we said, how can adults do this? Oh, it's this boy, I can still identify. My point and my message is, and I'm not digressing, I'm throwing before you multiple scenarios in every human life. I touched briefly so that I could touch on various aspects. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's teaching with fellow non-Muslims in the most hostile of climate, but how it paved the way to the beauty of Islam. We spoke about Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu honoring his word with a fellow non-Muslim. We then spoke about the aspect of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam respecting the seniors of his community, those that were literally his parents, those that were his foster mother, or that woman who was his slave and he elevated. And that is why the scholars say the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam summarized his 23 years of life in 2 words. Amongst his salient features was comprehensive speech. He said himself, أوتيت جوامع الكلم. Allah has favored me with comprehensive speech. So he could say great things in two words. And what was his last words? He said, As-salat wa ma malakat aymanukum, and he passed away. Fear Allah with regards to prayer, and fear Allah with regards to how you deal with your subjects and your subordinates. And that was his last words, and he passed away. Scholars say, if you unpack this, prayer is the most important in all your obligations to your Creator. So this was an hint to all the rights you owe to your Allah. And kindness to your servants was an hint to all the obligations you owe to fellow humans. And he singled out subjects because that is where you have authority. And if you can fear Allah where you have authority, you will fear Allah where you don't have authority. So that was a summary of his entire life. Whenever the fruit of a new season came, the Prophet ﷺ used to pray, Allahumma barik lana fi thamarina, wa barik lana fi sa'ina, wa barik lana fi muddina. And then he would call the youngest child. If there was someone in the gathering, and if the children were playing outside, he would say, call that young boy, the child will commence with the fruit of the new season. I'm saying there was a delicate balance. There was a fine line in which everybody was given time and recognition. To such an extent, there is a hadith, Amr ibn As radiallahu anhu one day said, I came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and I said, O Prophet of Allah, man ahabbu nasi ilayk? Who loves you the most? Who is most beloved to you? Now listen to this and look at how the scholar's eye is. Who is most beloved to you? So obviously this was a serious question and it had academic implications. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Aisha is most beloved to me. He then said, min al-rijal, from amongst the men, who is closest to you? Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the father of Aisha, and that is Abu Bakr. But the scholars say, what was the motivation of this man to ask the question? It was this perception that he was the most beloved because of the character of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The answer had to be given, which was the true answer, and you couldn't appease him by saying, you are the most beloved to me, because the truth is the truth, and we can tamper with the truth. But the scholars say, study the motivation. If you know you're not in the good books, you're not going to go and try your luck and say, who's most beloved to you? You're not going to try your luck. You will only muster the courage to ask that question if you have a perception. And I have three sons, and I know, and you have a classroom of 20, everyone, what? You like him more, you like her more, you take his part. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could impress 124,000, everyone believing Allah's Nabi loves me the most. So there was something to do with his character. Another amazing aspect in his life, and we often falter here, and this in particular with our spouses. When it comes to addressing our spouses, it's a challenging issue. We have interaction, we have to admonish, we have to discipline, whatever the dynamics are. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to use a hint, an indication, to minimize the impact of the chastisement. So instead of being explicit and emphatic, to make it mild. In English, they use the word euphemism. Euphemism, if you study it, it's of Greek origin. What it means, to use something that is more subtle and not explicit versus something that is emphatic and objectionable. So you come across in a more toned way, in a more mild way. This was the teaching then. Modern day civilization say that, you know, communication warrants that you must be sensitive to the temperament of your audience. This is all flowery language and they talk about all these things. But look at the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whenever he wanted to address something, he would use a roundabout approach. مَا بَالُ أَقْوَامٍ. Why are some people saying things like this? He will make an address so that no person feels the direct address, yet he gets the message and makes the necessary reformations. مَا بَالُ عَامِلٍ أَبْعَثُهُ فَيَقُولُ هَذَا لِي هَذَا لَكُمْ وَهَذَا أُهْدِيَ إِلَيَّ. Some people came and they asked Aisha radiallahu anha, what were his practices? And they said, she said that he eats also and he sleeps, he shares the bed and he fasts. So they felt, oh, we thought you were going to tell us whole night he worships and he never eats and that. And in their thoughts, there was the perception by their body language that they didn't feel it to be all that great. Then they said, maybe because he's a prophet, he doesn't have to exert his entire night in worship. So when the Prophet ﷺ came back, she bounced the sentiments of those people. People came, they asked me what you do by night. I told them you sleep and you pray. They asked me what you do by day. I say you eat and you fast, just depends. So they said, okay, that's for him, but for me, I'm going to fast for the rest of my life. For me, I'm going to worship Allah for the entire night. And me, I will do this here. The Prophet got very angry. And he said, are you thinking you can be more pious than me? Remember, nobody can fear Allah more than me. Wallahi, la ana akhshakum billah. And following my pattern is fearing Allah. And then he said, why do people make these comments? The point I'm saying is, subtle approach. Here is a beautiful example. You know, we need the broad shoulders and the thick skin and the intellectual mind to diffuse situations at home and not infuse it. And unfortunately today we've become masters in infusing things. We just know how to create, provoke, ignite and spark an argument. But we don't have what it takes. We don't have what it takes to diffuse the situation. I'm reminded that we'll digress. Let me share this incident with you rather first. The incident is very long. It comes in Bukhari Sharif, etc. It comes in the Quran, in Surah Tahrim, where the Prophet ﷺ used to make his regular visits daily to all his honorable spouses. This was just a passing visit after Asr, in addition to where he would spend the night. And just a walk-in greeting if they all are fine and all is okay. Every wife wanted to maximize the stay, which is great and meritorious, but if it happens at the cost of compromising her stay elsewhere, then Islam is not in harmony with that. We need to, this is the balance. I can be very kind to you, my brother, but if I'm holding up the traffic at the back, Islam doesn't welcome that kindness. Islam doesn't welcome that kindness. I am giving you away here, but I'm holding people at the back. If I can cause ease for others at the cost of difficulty on myself, that's the beauty, that's the character, that's what we have to do. But I inconvenience others to bring comfort to someone else, we've missed the idea. So Zainab radiallahu anha, his honorable spouse, she would every day say, can I prepare you some honey quickly? It's like, okay, prepare it, on the time to leave. And then he has it because he was very bashful. He couldn't say no. For us it's difficult to understand because we lack it. We can blatantly say no, and we say more than no. You know, one day I seen a brother coming and he was paralyzed or crippled and he was begging. And this brother was so harsh. He said, the next time you beg, I'll break your other leg. Wallah, it hit me so hard. I said, my brother, Allah can turn the tables. Allah can reverse things so instantly. And we've seen it happening. It's not unheard of. We've seen it happening. With the credit crunch that came biting through the economy, was it not people that were running big shops and big firms today are looking for job and are sleeping on the road? That's just a simple, common example we can identify with. But many things have happened and we've seen it with the naked eye. So the Prophet said, okay, I'll have your honey. He would sip the honey. This would cause delay because the time between Asr and Maghrib was short. So now his time at the one spouse is compromised, his time at the other spouse is compromised. Now between the spouses there were two groups. This is quite clear in the hadith that Aisha, Hafsa radiallahu anha was one group, there was another group. It was the balance and the maturity of a Nabi that could bear it and move it and carry on. And the wisdom amongst many other wisdom was that these women came from different tribes, so every one of them could narrate his personal private life to their tribes, thereby become a source of guidance. So remember that these marriages were not motivated by lust and other things. This was the divine planning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to preserve his internal bedroom life also to the world. And there is no human in history. If you open Ibn Majah, the book of Hadith, the scholars have a section debating how many strands of white hair were on his head the day he passed away. Even this has been debated. Leave everything else. How many strands of white hair on the blessed head of my Nabi since the day he passed away? There's a narration of 19, there's a narration of 20 strands, there's a narration of 21 strands. And then the Sahara, the scholars of Hadith, they reconcile the three verdicts. I'm saying to that minutest detail, no human's life has been preserved but Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is another topic which I have spoken about, is that one scholar has explained how Allah has spoken about every limb of the Prophet ﷺ in the Quran. I just run you through briefly. Number one, Allah says, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى. and al-aqma, one day the Prophet frowned. So Allah spoke about the frown of Nabi Sallallahu in the Quran. Then when he used to look to the heavens in anticipation of revelation, Allah said, قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ. We see your glance.